So after a recent live stream, I got this question from VSG Life that said, can you do a video around battlefield station setup from mic to camera to audio, etc.? Why, yes. Yes, I can. So when you're building out your battlefield, ready to go, live streaming and video station, you really want to think about the system of gear that you would need to buy to make this possible. You don't ever want to just buy individual pieces of gear that people recommend. And this is where a lot of people, before they have even gotten started, mess up, because they're always looking for the best camera for YouTube, the best microphone, but they aren't looking for the best microphone for the kind of content that they're trying to make, or the kind of camera based on the things that they're planning to create. Because just YouTube videos is a very broad category, and I get where you're coming from, but it just isn't going to help you the best. So I'm gonna give you one that can kind of work depending on what you're trying to do, and you can feel free to swap out the microphone or the camera based on your individual needs, but this is where most people kind of fit in my audience. So this setup is one that I've given to different clients and associates that are getting ready to get started building one, and they were trying to use like the Shure SM7B, Rodecaster Pro. Feel free to swap out any of these that you prefer, but this is the system of gear and how it would connect together. When you have the XLR microphone, you have the Shure SM7B or any other type of XLR microphone. When it's XLR, that's that traditional kind of like analog audio. So you need that three-prong XLR cable to go from the microphone. And because I'm using a preamp mic for this Shure SM7B, just to give it a little bit cleaner gain, we're using the FET head. So not everyone likes the FET head in the front of the microphone so that it's visible. I don't like that either, and it does not have to go there. It can go directly into the back of your audio interface. For this one, it's gonna be the Rodecaster Pro. For what's coming out of the Rodecaster Pro, this is gonna be that USB-C connection. Rode includes a USB cable, but I don't actually like the way this one performs. And most people that I know that's used this Rodecaster Pro for any length of time end up replacing it anyway. So I just bought a USB-C to USB-C cable that goes from the Rodecaster into my computer. The adapter is not necessary if you don't need it, so feel free to skip that one. And from there, that cable is now connecting into your computer. Depending on what kind of microphone and audio interface that you're gonna use, you wanna make sure that you're very comfortable with getting the optimal settings so that it sounds the best. For me, with the Shure SM7B and the Rodecaster Pro, I actually did a video all about it. If you wanna check that out, click on the information screen, but let's dive into the video side of things. So here we are at the gear connection page, and this setup is very simple. Again, depending on what kind of camera that you need, what settings that you're trying to get, that's gonna dictate what camera that you buy. If you're new to cameras and all of those different things, really think about what are the different ways that you're going to use this camera. And don't just say YouTube videos. Really think about, are you doing podcasts? With those podcasts, or do you intend for them to go over 30 minutes? Do you intend for them to go over an hour or more? Is battery life going to be something that's an issue? I don't care what camera you use. Battery life is going to be a thing, and you want to get an AC power adapter. That's going to dictate the kind of accessories that you want and things like that. Most people are thinking through wanting a high quality setup. That means getting lights and getting your audio game together. We'll touch on mics, audios, and lenses a little bit in just a second, but let's dive back over to the page. Once you have your camera picked out, you want to now take that camera and connect it to your computer. The way that you're going to go about doing this is getting a micro HDMI cable. That's usually what most cameras take, sub $1,000 mirrorless cameras that if they're within the last 3, maybe 4 years old. And now you need to get that cable, links to everything on this page and in the description, over to the Cam Link. I prefer the Elgato Cam Link 4K. It just tends to give the best results in my opinion, as well as pretty good color accuracy. That has a male and female port on it. The female port is going to be the HDMI port. The male side of it is going to be a USB 3.0. If you're new to using the Elgato Cam Link, you want to make sure this is actually going into a USB 3.0 port. Most devices like the CalDigit TS3 will let you know which ones are USB 3.0 ports or maybe USB 2.0 port. Or if you have an older computer, make sure that your computer meets the requirements for this actual device. All individual devices, cables, accessories, whatever, tend to have specific requirements in order for you to use it. So if your computer is not compatible, know that this will not work for you, unfortunately. So now that you have your HDMI cable connected to your computer and then into the cable, it now would go a USB 3.0 extension cable. They give you a little one in the box with the cam link, but I recommend getting a longer one. So if you want to set your camera further away from you, you have the ability to make that stretch without losing any frames or not having any issues. So you want to get a USB 3.0 cable. But honestly, go ahead and buy the right cable with the right connections that you need. Every time you introduce any kind of new little adapter, it's a new point of failure in your setup, and you'll be trying to figure out why is something not working or why is the camera feed looking weird. And from there, we're connecting this into the computer. So once you have this all set up, now it's time to get into the where you're putting everything. Now, I usually set up my desk depending on where am I going to sit, where's that camera going to go, and what's going to be honestly most comfortable for me as I'm going through and creating content. I tend to work in a pretty noisy environment, so when it comes to the microphones that I use, I want to make sure that my microphones can reject the background noise. Something like this Shure SM7B will honestly be very good. I can kind of have it right here and it'll sound awesome. But some people have an issue with mics being in the shot, so we'll push that away. Now, at that point, if you don't want your mic in the shot, you really, really, really need to consider, what kind of environment are you in? Do you have sound dampening panels? Do you have a mover's blanket or something up around you to kind of help just absorb some of the background noise? If the answer is no, and that starts to complicate things, then you do want this dynamic style podcast type microphone, especially when you're at the desk. So if you have airplanes, you have kids, you have TV on in the background, this is only going to pick up the audio about the size of your head from around you, and it'll reject everything else. And you have software tools like the Rode Connect application or a Rodecaster Pro that can help with rejecting background noise. If you want to use a condenser style microphone, those are going to pick up more noises around you, but you can get a true dedicated boom microphone, so that way it works a little bit better. So right now in this whole video, you've been listening to a actual dedicated and real condenser style microphone, but it's a gradient style condenser microphone. That means that the audio that's close to me is going to sound good. The further you get away or down the tube of that microphone, it goes and it gets quieter as it rejects more of the background noise. The next part of your setup is going to be the lighting. And honestly, when you're thinking about your setup, it should be the audio, lighting, and then the cameras, but I know everybody loves to do the camera stuff first. Now, the lighting that you use, it should be a continuous lighting source. So things that are like those umbrella lights that you usually will see, those are photography-based lights and really aren't designed for video. And you want to make sure that you're not getting anything that's flickering in the background or causing any other issues. Now, the lighting setup that I'm currently using and that you're looking at right now is actually from a Viltrox lighting kit that I highly, highly recommend. It's a continuous lighting source. The LED panels are really thin, and you want to make sure you're getting something that will soften the light. I did a whole dedicated video on white balancing your camera, as well as make sure you're getting a dedicated lighting source that's going to work for you. So feel free to check out those full length videos. No matter what you use for your dedicated setup in your studio space, you still need to know how to set your camera up. And I want to walk you through how can you leverage the automatic settings on your camera to help educate you on what are some things that you should change. And I did a whole dedicated video that's coming up on the screen that I highly recommend that you check out.